a few things to do today, and we may or may not get through all of them. There are a couple more papers and sort of core methodologies that I do want to talk about that are the PowerPoints that was posted up on Blackboard from before. And so we will get to that, but possibly not until Tuesday. Like it says over there, turn in your homework, and there's two handouts to pick up. The single page front and back is the group assignment that you're going to be doing. Hopefully you know what your groups are. If not, there's a link on the announcements part on Blackboard to the Google Doc where you can find who your groups are. And you're going to get to meet your groups at the end of class today. There's a fair amount of work to do over the weekend for that assignment, and at the end of class today, we'll spend a little bit of time talking about that. In addition to that, there is a homework assignment that is going to be due 1 week from today that is two pages. Some questions about some stuff from fluorescent molecules and the relates to how your eye works and so on, and the quantum mechanics, absorption of photons by electrons stuff. The main purpose of that problem is to give you a sense of what I hope you do have taken away from it. There were a lot of equations and a lot of details that I threw at you over the course of those couple of lectures, and that first problem is designed to help you know what you should understand. The second problem on that problem set is related to stuff I'm going to start off talking about today, which is we're going to move into a discussion of electrical activity in neurons and how that relates to relating concentrations of ions to electrical potentials. For those of you who have had either Molecules to Mind or Cellular Neuroscience or possibly even Physiology or other classes, some of this will be familiar, but there's sort of a slightly different angle that we're going to take on it, even than I took in my other class, Molecules to Mind, although there is a lot of overlap. But hopefully the refresher will be helpful, if nothing else. Okay, and then problem two on the homework is related to especially the fusion aspect of that. Any questions about any of that? Okay. Before we talk about diffusion of molecules, we're going to talk about something even a little bit simpler. If I have four rooms and four cages. So I've got a chicken farm. And in my chicken farm, I've got four cages. And the chickens are completely interchangeable with each other. They're identical twins, completely indistinguishable from one another. And there's only space for one chicken in each of the cages. So I've got space for four. I have space for four chickens. I don't have four chickens right now. I only have two chickens. So I can call my chickens chicken A and chicken B, and then I can also give my rooms designation, or my cages, cage 1, 2, and 3, and 4. You're welcome to sort of work this out on your own, but if the chickens are indistinguishable from each other, then having a chicken A in here and B in there is identical to having chicken B here and A there. They're indistinguishable chickens, so it's the same scenario. The possible arrangements that I could have are that I could have a chicken A, that I could have a chicken in coop 1 and coop 2, a chicken in coop 1 and coop 3, chicken in coop 1 and coop 4, 2 and 3, 2 and 4, or 3 and 4. And so there are 8 possible arrangements of chickens there. In physics, It turns out that there actually is a quantifiable, although extremely small, amount of energy associated with the arrangement of my chickens in these coops. This energy is an energy that comes from a physical force or a physical phenomenon, which is known as the second law of thermodynamics. Which has a variety of different arrangements or different statements associated with it. Who's heard the second law of thermodynamics? It's not Isaac Asimov. That joke might be out, but you didn't know. Does anyone want to say how they've heard the second law of thermodynamics? Care to volunteer what they've heard before? Nicole, you raised your hand, I think. What did you hear? No? Have you ever? Okay. I misremembered. So let's see. Who else did hear? Bridget, have you heard of it? What's the second law of thermodynamics? No, this is Newton's one second law of motion. Yeah, sure, Michael. Yeah. The things move from one, things sort of disperse from one place to another. Not quite, but I think you're on the right track. Yeah, sure, Jay.
So entropy or like disorder is always increasing.
Yeah, the entropy, which approximately equals disorder, always increases. Another way to think about entropy itself is sort of disorder is a somewhat useful way sometimes to think about entropy. I sort of like to think of entropy more in terms of dispersion. So things tend to spread out over time. That's a little bit circular in a sense. But another way to define entropy, so. Entropy, the variable, the letter that we use for entropy is S. And so S, entropy, is equal to some physical constant called Boltzmann's constant, which we're going to not care about in a couple seconds, times the natural log of this term omega. And so what the heck is omega? Omega is the number of ways a system can be arranged. So back over here in this situation, if I have four cages and two chickens, then omega equals what? 8. Yes. Number of ways I can arrange my system is 8. Okay. All right. So before I move on to slightly more complicated situation, what questions do people have about this? Yeah. Sure.
Why is it 8 and not 6?
Did I miscount? I totally miscounted. Ha! 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6! Yes. 6 ways I can arrange this. Thank you for catching that. Sorry about that. 6 ways I can arrange this. Other questions or things that I screwed up with? Yes.
What is the Boltzmann constant?
Constant. If you've heard of the what is the Boltzmann constant? We've seen that equation before. Okay. So this is for a gas. For a balloon filled with the gas of helium, then we can, if we put, so there this sort of relates the pressure and the volume to the number of moles, which is, a mole is just six times 10 to the 23rd atoms, or anything really. You could have a mole of people, but that would cover like most of the solar system or something. T is temperature in degrees Kelvin, and then in order to relate these things, we use this this thing called the ideal gas constant, R. So R turns out to be equal to 8.3, let me sure I get my units right, joules, which is a measure of energy, per mole, that's 6 times 10 to the 23rd, per degree Kelvin. So T is temp in degrees Kelvin, and then N is number of moles, mole is 6 times 10 to the 23rd atoms or ions or whatever. In this, I'm going to write volume here, VOL, because in a couple minutes we're going to start using V for voltage, and I don't want that to be confusing. So vol is volume, which is measured in liters, and then P is pressure, body equals volume. So the ideal gas constant is all about things bouncing around and jiggling around in space. So if we're talking about moles of stuff, it turns out that the ideal gas constant is how we really is going to come into our entropy equation. But sometimes we're interested in, like, what is the entropy associated with a single atom? And so for a single atom, Boltzmann's constant is just equal to R divided by 6 times 10 to the 23rd atoms, or even chickens would work for this actually, but things per mole. So it ends up being 8.3 joules per degree Kelvin, because we have mole in the denominator here, mole in the denominator up above, so those cancel out, divided by 6 times 10 to the 23rd. So it's an exceedingly small number, which gives us per atom what the entropy is. So it's sort of like the ideal gas constant on a per atom basis instead of a per mole basis, is what both. We're not going to be after about 10 minutes. We're never going to see Boltzmann's constant again. So that part you can sort of ignore. Although the rest of this, the only thing I'm here that's really sort of critical for us is this. And the reason that this becomes useful is this ideal gas constant is really just all about things moving around and the energy associated with things moving around. So this equation, if I put more stuff in to my balloon, then it either has to get bigger, or if I hold it so the volume doesn't get any bigger, then the pressure is gonna increase. If I increase my temperature, the things bounce around more. And so again, either it needs to get bigger or the pressure is gonna increase. And if I squeeze it smaller, then and keep the temperature and number of things constant, then by definition the pressure gets higher. So that's how this comes up in chemistry. We are not going to use that equation. Literally the only thing over here that matters in about 5 more minutes is this, the ideal gas constant. Yeah. Other questions about this? Okay. So, I decide, as a chicken farmer here, that even though I've only got two chickens, I'm very optimistic for the future, and so I am going to buy a few more cages and expand my chicken farm. So now I have four cages, still have two chickens.
Eight.
No, four chickens. Two chickens, still two
chickens. Eight cages.
My goodness. This is what happens when your two-year-old wakes up in the middle of the night and can't get back to sleep for a while. Okay. But the good thing about having two-year-olds is you can blame them for you. Okay. Eight cages, two chickens. I could sort of like lock the door here so that my chickens are stuck in these two cages. And if I keep that door locked, then there are still only six possible places. And so when I confine my chickens to four cages, then the number of ways the system can be arranged is still six. And so the entropy associated with that is Boltzmann constant times the natural log of 6. But if I unlock the door and allow the chickens to be in any of these 8 cages, then somebody can double check me on this. I'm not going to write out all 28 possibilities, but I will say that now if the chickens are unconfined, then now there are 28 different ways that they could be arranged in my 8 boxes. And so entropy of the system is going to be Boltzmann constant times the natural log of 28. And the natural log, does anyone have a calculator to calculate the natural log of 6 and the natural log of 28? Kind of doesn't matter. The main point is that natural log of 28 is bigger than the natural log of 6. The natural log of 6 is something around, so some constant times 1.8, and then this is going to be something around like
3.3.
Yeah, okay. Times 3.3. So we've approximately doubled the entropy of our system by doubling the space, which is somewhat intuitively satisfactory. And so what that means is that dispersing things into more spaces, allowing them to spread out, leads to an increase in entropy. And so if there's no other forces acting on the system, like I don't put some food over on this side so that the chickens are sort of attracted over there or something like that, then according to the second law of thermodynamics, things diffuse out. And that is the physical driving force for diffusion in general. All right, so what questions do people have about that right there? Yeah. Yeah, so there's one chicken on either side. I think that means there are 8 possibilities. I think that's right. If there's one chicken on either side, then it's 16 possibilities. So there are 4 ways here and 4 ways here. And so actually, we can even do a little bit more with this, which is to say, so if I combine, if the chickens, the chickens being both on the left, omega equals 6, chickens being both on the right half, omega equals 6 again. And then the chickens being 1 in each side, then omega equals 16. And I think 12, yes, that adds up to 20. Because there's 4 times 4 different places. Each chicken has 4 choices. And so that actually even takes us a little bit further, which is to say that in this case, it's kind of close because we've got a fairly small system. As the system gets larger and larger, the difference between having the chickens on opposite sides versus having the chickens on the same side becomes more and more dramatic. But even with this relatively simple system, we are unlikely to find both chickens on the same side. Because the sum of these, both on the same side, but I don't care which, omega equals 12. So my higher entropy state is to have the chickens on spread out into the two different sides, which is analogous to if you have a drop of dye that you put in water, finding it all on the left side of the beaker versus finding it all on the right side of the beaker are both exceedingly unlikely, and in fact, ridiculously more unlikely than finding the dye sort of diffuse more or less evenly throughout the entire thing. And so even here in this, we see the higher entropy state is to have the chickens end up on opposite sides, even if they don't care about one another. It's not like they're actively avoiding each other here. We're giving them freedom to be anywhere except in the same cage as the other chicken. But even in that situation, where they don't like hate each other and seek to go away, they just, by probability alone, tend to be found on opposite sides of our sort of midline. And so again, that's sort of telling us that dispersing things in more space, spreading out, increases entropy. Okay. Questions about that? All right. So move that up for a second. Like I said, we'll be done with that soon, but I'll leave it up for just another minute, just in case. All right. So now, moving into an example that I think some of you have already seen, which is, now let's say I've got, say I've got a little beaker. The whole beaker has a volume of 2 liters, and I have some membrane that I insert that separates left and right side of our beaker. And in this situation with my beaker, I have over here a concentration of 100 millimolar glucose. In case anybody doesn't know, the little m just means 10 to the minus 3. You know, this is micro, 10 to the minus 6. Nano, just 10 to the minus 9. And pico, just 10 to the minus 12. Those are just shorthand for small sizes. And then the capital M equals moles per liter. So there's a tenth of a mole of glucose over here. And a 20th of a mole of glucose over here. And so there's some organization to this system at this starting point where there is more glucose over here. So if you think of entropy in terms of disorder, there's some organization where it kind of organized some glucose over to this side of the system. It turns out that when we're dealing with concentrations like this, there's a slightly different expression for entropy that can be derived from that, but we're not going to work through that because it would take the whole rest of the class period to do, where entropy, now since we're talking about moles, we're going to use the ideal gas constant instead of Boltzmann's constant, again, times the natural log of the concentration of whatever stuff you're dealing with. There's actually a little correcting fact you have to put in there as well that we're gonna that kind of ends up canceling out, so we're gonna skip this. So the entropy associated with the system is that. We can figure out the entropy of one side versus the other. We can also figure out the change in entropy from one side to the other. And so change in something is just taking one state minus another state. So it's going to be R times the log of concentration of glucose on the left minus you can do it either way, but it just tells us which direction things are moving. Minus R times the log of the concentration of glucose on the left. And if you remember your pre-calculus and logarithms, then we can factor R out. So it's going to be R times the difference between these two logs. And then log of X minus log of Y is just equal to log of X over Y. If the logarithm stuff is a little bit unfamiliar, then I encourage you to spend a little bit of time looking it up. Especially the property of adding and subtracting and multiplying logarithms by things. But this is now our expression for the difference in entropy present in the system. Okay. What questions do people have about that? All right. So now we're going to go from here and put a little hole in the membrane that is a glucose channel. So it's a little protein that lets glucose pass through any which way it wants. Let's say I take one of these glucose molecules here, and say I take a couple of these glucose molecules here, maybe four of them, and I put I put some radioactive carbon in these four glucose molecules. So they chemically behave exactly like any other glucose molecule. But I can track where they are by observing the radioactive. So first of all, before we worry about our radioactive glucose for a second, when I open this channel, what is the overall direction of flow of glucose going to be? Over this way to the right. Yep. So glucose flows to the right. In aggregate. Do any glucose molecules at all go left? Who thinks yes? Who thinks no? All right, good. So a couple people didn't answer. Most people think yes. Yeah, so another way to describe this increase in entropy or this tendency for entropy is just as things jiggle around, they don't care. It's not like these glucose molecules are, first of all, the glucose molecules are not repelled from one another. Just like the chickens over here, they weren't avoiding each other just by chance. It happens that it's more likely to find them on separate sides than it is to find them on the same side. Similarly over here, the glucose molecules aren't repelled from one another. They're just jiggling around in the solution happily however they go, and some of them go this way and some of them go that way. It's just there's a heck of a lot more glucose over here, and so more of them will go this way. But actually, just like our chickens, after we let this go to equilibrium, we can see that some of the glucose went this way, because probably what will happen is maybe one or two radioactive glucose will end up over here, and then one, two, or three will end up over here, and one, two, or three will end up over there. But we'll be able to actually prove that even though the overall net flow of glucose is this way, the glucose molecules are going everywhere. So what questions do people have about that? Okay, so if I let this go forever and ever until the end of time, what is going to be the final concentration of glucose? 75, right, we're just going to average it out. So we'll end up with 75 millimolar glucose over here. The channel's still open. 75 millimolar glucose over here. Glucose molecules are still moving around, it's just now that they're moving equally from one side to the other. And so this isn't a frozen state, but we call it an equilibrium. And in this case, since the only energy that was present in the system to start with was energy associated with the entropy, and actually one of the homework problems asks you to calculate for a particular temperature in joules what the energy is. But the only energy that we had to worry about was the energy associated with entropy, which I sometimes will call the diffusional energy, or the entropic energy. Sometimes I'll be sloppy with my terms and call it diffusional force or entropic force, but really it's an energy because it's measured in joules. And so the energy, this is equal to the temperature of the system times delta S, or if we expand out what delta S is, R times the temperature times the natural log of the concentration of glucose on the right over the concentration of glucose on the left. Any questions about that? Okay, a couple more quick examples. So if I have a situation here where now I have a 3-liter container, and there's 1 liter on this side of the membrane, and 2 liters on this side of the membrane, and again, 100 millimolar glucose, and 50 millimolar glucose, what is the, actually let's make it slightly easier and call it, well, I don't know. 50 millimolar glucose. So what's the equilibrium, once after I open this and let it diffuse forever and ever, what's the equilibrium concentration going to be? I'll give everybody like 2 minutes, 3 minutes to work that out. So find a neighbor if you want to and just try and work out what the equilibrium concentration is going to be in this situation.
Saying 100 micromolar and 50 micromolar or millimolar. I can't see it either.
Okay.
Oh yeah, but the volume.
Okay, Okay, so it's been a couple minutes, so what number did people come up with? Anybody want to volunteer what number they came up with for this? Sure, yeah. Yeah, so the way we figure it out is we just, first we have to figure out essentially the total amount of glucose that we have. And so we have 3 liters total. And in that 3 liters, we have 2 liters times 50 millimolar plus 1 liter times 100 millimolar. And so that then equals, so this is going to be 100 liters times millimolar, which is actually millimoles, but we'll just leave it like that, plus 100 liters times millimolar. Then what we do is we take all of that and divide it by our total volume. So we end up, so we have 200 liters times millimolar divided by 3 liters. So our liters cancel out. We're going to be left with millimolar again. And that works out to be 66.7 millimolar. And so kind of makes sense since the 50 millimolar chamber was bigger, it contributes, we get closer to it than to the 100 millimolar. So you could do another one where we have 1 liter over here and 10 liters over there, in which case you're going to be very close to 50. It might be like, I don't know, maybe 55 or 52.5. We have to sort of work it out. But as the volume of one gets bigger and bigger, our final equilibrium concentration is going to get closer and closer to that. So one other thing that I can do is I can have a one liter solution and then a little sphere encased in membrane that has a volume of 1 nanoliter, so 10 to the minus 9 liters. And then again, I'll put 50 millimolar in here, to keep it consistent, 100 millimolar in here, 50 millimolar out here, open a channel, let the stuff diffuse. Anyone want to take a guess about approximately what the final concentration everywhere is going to be by the end of this scenario? 50. Yeah, it'll be like ever so slightly, like 50.01 millimolar at the end of this. So as you deal, and if one compartment is way the heck smaller than another, then you're sort of swimming in a sea of this stuff, and that's going to determine if we're dealing with just diffusion, what the equilibrium concentration is. Okay. Other questions about this? Okay. So coming back over here for a second. In this case, the only energy that we had to worry about was energy associated with entropy. But in fact, there are other types of energy that exist in the world, and the other types of energy involve essentially potential energy changes as something moves from one place to another. You can sort of think of it like if I have food on one side of the chicken coop, then there's going to be a tendency for the chickens to spend a little bit more time over there because they're drawn over to that side. They're sort of being pulled over there. And so there's a quantifiable energy associated with that. And so overall, when we're interested in kind of all forms of energy, that drive a chemical process, we can generally break it down into two different parts. One is the energy associated with entropy, and the other is the energy associated with changes in potential energy, which a change in potential energy we talk about is enthalpy, and so one term for this would be the enthalpic energy. And we use for a change in energy associated with potential energy, we use the variable delta H instead of delta S, like we did for H. And then, probably an equation that many, but maybe not all of you have seen before, is the equation for what's called Gibbs free energy. We're using this term delta G to combine these two, and delta G just equals the change in enthalpy minus the temperature times delta S. And so for a chemical reaction, for example, if I was doing something like this, 2H2 plus 1O2 getting converted into two H2Os, there is a heck of a lot of heat that comes off of this, and so we have delta H is going to be negative for this reaction, and so negative Gibbs free energy drives a reaction one way. It turns out there's a little bit of a change in entropy, but not much associated with that. If there is positive Gibbs free energy, then that means that the tendency is to not go this way. So if I wrote the reaction this way, 2H2O goes to 2H2 plus O2, this is going to have a delta H that is positive and an overall Gibbs free energy that is positive. And so that means that the reaction resists going this way and in fact is going to be driven still. Equilibrium will be more toward the left on this reaction. So positive Gibbs free energy means that the reaction is driven the other way. So if I have anything going on, any possible movement of stuff or whatever, the Gibbs free energy is going to tell me whether it's going to go one way or the other. And then there's a final scenario, which is that if delta G equals zero, that is actually the definition of something being in equilibrium. So before, when we were talking about diffusion alone, equilibrium just depended on entropy because there wasn't any other energy involved. But now, when delta G equals zero, our diffusion is equal to, that would be a case where when we account for all of the energies that might be around, equilibrium is the point where delta G is equal to zero. Questions about that? All right. So now, 45 minutes in, we're going to start doing some neuroscience. Okay. So, I got myself a little tiny neuron. Drawing it big so I can put stuff in it, but it's swimming in a sea of extracellular fluid that has a lot more volume than the cell itself has. And neurons actually expend a lot of energy. 70 to 90% of the energy they expend is to do one thing. The ATP that they expend is to do one thing, which is to force sodium ions out and potassium ions in. The movement of sodium ions out is something that is energetically unfavorable, so they have to use ATP to do it. The movement of potassium ions in is energetically unfavorable, so they have to use ATP to do it. And we'll see why it's actually, in a second, energetically favorable, for example, for potassium to go out. But in our neuron, if it's healthy and alive and everything, then there's approximately 150 millimolar concentration of sodium out here, maybe 5 millimolar or so potassium ions, something like 150 millimolar chloride ions, and then maybe 1 millimolar calcium, maybe a little bit of magnesium, and then maybe a few other anions out there, something like 7-ish millimolar other anions like phosphate and carbonate and stuff like that. So overall, there's sort of like no sort of imbalance of charges out here. And then inside our neuron, things are kind of the opposite of where they were out there. So inside our neuron, 15 millimolar sodium, about 100 millimolar potassium, about another 15 millimolar chloride, and then essentially no calcium, and around 100 millimolar of other anions that we don't care about, except that they make sure that our neuron doesn't get electrocute itself. And so those are sort of the mixes of ions that are floating around. Okay, so at a certain point in time, let's just, another thing that neurons have is they have voltage. And so we have voltage out, and for our purposes, we're always comparing the voltage in from the voltage out, and so our reference voltage is out, and so by definition, the voltage out equals zero. And let's say that right now, at this moment in time, the voltage inside our neuron is equal to the voltage outside, so it's also zero. So there's no voltage difference across the neuron. And I open up the channel. Now this channel lets potassium flow through, and some potassium comes in on its own because things are always jiggling every which way. But in aggregate, on average, what's the net flow of potassium going to be? Out. Right. More potassium goes out than in because there's a higher concentration here, and there's no, and at this point, the only force we have to worry about, or the only energy we have to worry about, is the energy associated with entropy. And that energy associated with entropy is going to drive the potassium out. Not because the potassium ions are repelled. In fact, if you add everything up, there's just as many negative as positive charges in here. So they're perfectly happy here, and they have no more happy outside. In fact, in a minute, they're going to start to be, in a certain sense, happier inside than out. But just because of random motion and entropy, they're going to be moving out, even though there's no, like, they're not repelling each other and forcing each other out by some repulsion. It's just by entropy and diffusion and randomness and the second law of thermodynamics, which I never found. Okay. What questions do people have about all of that so far? Okay, so potassium ions leaving, and they're positively charged. Unlike our glucose that had no charge, the potassium ions are leaving and they're positively charged. So as they leave, we're going to continue to say that by definition, voltage outside is zero. But by comparison to outside, what's the voltage inside going to start to look like? Negative, right. Because positive ions are going away, and so our voltage inside is not going to be zero, it's going to start to become negative. We're going to have left behind a few extra negative charges. It turns out that it's some inconsequential number of ions, and I'd be happy to work through for anybody how many ions that is, but some ions start to flow out. And so at some point, as there starts to be a voltage, a negative voltage inside, now there's a different form of energy that we have to worry about. And that is an energy associated with the attractive force for positive potassium ions to the negative environment inside the cell. And that is that energy going to be pulling potassium in or pushing it further out? Somebody mumbled something and I didn't hear that. Annie, what do you think?
Or
Just the negative charge. Don't worry about the concentration difference. So negative charges here, positive potassium ions, what are they going to want to do?
Pull it back.
Yeah, pull it back in, right. So, and so we can say that then we have an enthalpic for an enthalpic energy associated with the pull of potassium back in. And that enthalpic energy is defined by this equation. Z here is the charge on the ion. So for potassium, that's plus one. For sodium, it's plus one. For chloride, the charge is minus one. For calcium, the charge is plus two. And that just means that if you have a calcium ion that's got twice as much positive charge packed onto it, it's going to feel twice as strong a force pulling it in as a sodium ion or potassium ion with one charge. F, so for a reminder, R is 8.3 joules per mole per degree Kelvin. And R is all about aggregate movements of atoms that are just diffusing around. F is known as Faraday's constant, and it is somewhat analogous to R in that it's about sort of the gross movement of electrical charges in some sort of electrical field. And so F equals 96,000, let me make sure I get my units right, coulombs per mole. So what the heck is a coulomb? Well, a volt is 1 joule per coulomb. So again, we're sort of relating voltage and charge with energy and the force that this is going to be. Okay. Questions about that? Yes.
So when the potassium channel opens, only potassium is getting transported, right?
That's exactly right, yeah. So these channels are extremely selective, and they have a tiny little hole that is perfectly sized so that only potassium can go through, sodium can't get through it, no negative charges can go through it, chloride can't go through it, nothing else, just potassium. That's the only thing that's allowed to pass through this hole. Yeah, very important. Other questions about that? Okay, so I have a question for all of you. So if we assume that the overall concentrations don't change very much, that is, only small numbers of ions move, then at equilibrium, what is Vn? What is voltage in? And so you're going to have to use Gibbs free energy, this definition of equilibrium, these constants, our definition of delta H, and also our definition of delta S over here. And I guess one other thing that I should point out is that in this situation here where we're dealing with a cell, delta S equals R times the natural log of the concentration of the ion out divided by the concentration of the ion in. So rather than left and right, we're dealing with right and left, we're dealing with out and in. So using all of that, in the next 10 minutes, try to figure out what is going to be the final equilibrium voltage for our potassium ions floating across the system. And do this together, sorry. Introduce yourself to your neighbors if you haven't done this already. Find a group, write your names on a piece of paper together, show your work, and give it to you. Sorry. This is so cool. Stay high to your friends.
Who's my gummy host?
Did you say
Yoga? Yeah, who is my gummy host? Who? Oh, on again? Okay. She's in the Hiller Lab. Minden Lab.
Yeah.
You can always go to CMU bio and look at the pictures and find them.
Yeah. Oh, yes! You do need a temperature. Okay. For biological systems, temperature is always 310 degrees Kelvin. This ma'am, which is all I care about.
I would say yes. I would say yes.
Just potassium.
There we go.
Yeah, the only thing that we're letting go through the memory is potassium. Also, you have concentration of potassium out, concentration of potassium in. You have your ideal gas constant and your temperature. Delta H is here. And delta G is here. Voltage.
Oh, it's here?
Yes.
I can try, Nancy. Yes. The outside is always defined as reference zero. Like, so for a second I was like, voltage moving out, and I'm like, no, the voltage outside is always defined as the reference of zero, and so you're finding the inside voltage in comparison. I hope. That is my understanding.
Oh, I'm sorry. How did you do that?
drive the nerds
oh,
to come
you're
to.
Doing that. Got it.
Ultimately.
Well, why don't we just all
what's that? Not my stuff so much. Other people's stuff is. They're resubmitting any day now.
So about 3 more minutes to finish out finding the final voltage.
Neat stuff in the SNR to back up their findings in the rescue. So it overall turned into a stronger paper, most like. But there's still, at least one of the reviewers, you could tell, just hated it. Hated the acute model. So it's a crapshoot, whether it makes it in.
It's almost the exact same thing as like not as one. But it's like an acute model.
Mm-hmm.
It had reviewers just destroyed it.
It's
like this is the long this is happening slowly all the time, like it's progressive.
They managed to I don't know if it's going in the paper, I think it is. They did manage to show rescue in some gradual animals. We don't know right now what their dopamine levels were. Like, our microtome's broken, and so they've been using Allison's, which requires blowing on it, and it's much more, it's not the temperature set one, so it's one that you have to use the dry ice with, and so that's why I'm not sure if they ended up putting it in the paper, because they don't have quantification of pH levels, I don't think, on any of the gradual animals.
Okay, so what value, does anybody want to share the final value that they came up with for this? You did this last semester, so you didn't get to share it with me again. It was a year ago, but anyway, even so. Somebody, sure. -80 what? Millivolts. That's exactly right. So our final VM, -80 millivolts. If you didn't get that, what we'll do is actually, you can either turn the sheets in now, or if you think that there's a mistake, you turn the sheets in at the end of class, or if you think that there's a mistake and you want to correct it, then you can work on it and turn them in on Tuesday to correct the study. Any questions about what you just did? What questions do people have? Okay, so a couple of reminders. You should have already turned in your homework up front. There were a couple of handouts out there. One of them is about the blog assignments that you'd have to do over the weekend. There's an additional homework that is due 1 week from today that is up on Blackboard now. It relates to all of the stuff we talked about today, plus the quantum absorption of light from earlier on, and so it's a chance to give you a sense of what you ultimately should be able to do from all of that. For the handouts, there are two of them, and one of them is this article about couch potatoes and hitchhikers on teams, because you're doing a team project, the main point of that is just that even though you don't get any shared grades, all of the grades are just based on what you put in, a lot of the blog project, as you read through the assignment, will require you to make a response to something somebody else has already posted. If something comes up where you are going to be behind in the work, you should let your teammates know, your two teammates know what's, you don't have to tell them what's happening, just let them know that you're going to be late. And then CC me and Teresa on that. And then you should also, if you don't want to share with everybody, just share with me only, like what's a little bit more about the particulars of why you're late. And then we'll work with your teammates to make sure that the situation that came up for you doesn't impact their ability to complete their parts of the assignment. But generally, your teammates are going to be relying on you, and so that's sort of the main point of that. So for the last 15 minutes here in class, let's get our screens back down here. We are going to find our teammates, introduce yourselves to your teammates. Not yet, but in a second, you will go to an assigned spot for your team. I'll put my hand just making that way first. Go to an assigned spot, find your group, introduce yourselves, exchange your contact information with your group. And then there are three papers that are available on Blackboard. You have to be primary poster for one, responder to a different one from the one you're primary poster on, and recapper for whichever one you didn't do the other two things on. So you're going to fill all three roles. So one person's primary poster. Anyway, the blog assignment explains it's not clear. So everybody's primary post is due on Monday. Everybody's response is due on Tuesday of next week, and then we have until Thursday the 7th, maybe Tuesday the 7th, to do the recap. And we're going to have some class time on Tuesday the 7th to help prepare for the recap. But the primary post and the response are things that you're going to do outside of class. Over the weekend, you should read all of these papers and talk to your groups, and to me, and to Teresa about what questions you have. I expect that you'll have to also do a little bit of work on your own, and also contact us, and we'll open up some sort of places where we can also have space to comment on and collaboratively discuss some of the methods, some of which are going to be unfamiliar. Okay, any questions about any of that? Yeah. Okay, so on the Google Doc, you all had a letter assigned, or an alligator, bear, or whatever. So alligators in the very front over here, then bears, crocodiles, and deer, or whatever it was, and then in the second row, EFGH, and the third row, and so on. So go ahead and go there to wherever you're supposed to be to find what you've done. And then turn it in on your way.
That's nice. DJ, I can turn this off. Yes, okay.